Ladies and gentlemen, once again, it's my great pleasure to welcome you for this fourth lecture of the lecture series on sovereign debt. This lecture series is organized by the Max Planck Society, Max Planck Institute Luxembourg, with the support of the Fonds National de la Recherche du Luxembourg. So we're going more and more in depth in this fascinating topic, and I'm very happy to see you so numerous today. I'm very pleased to welcome two distinguished lecturers today for this lecture. Michael Waibel will take the floor to talk about investment arbitration as a means of resolving sovereign debt disputes. Michael is professor at the University of Cambridge. He belongs to this young and very promising professors, and he has received many awards for this. I remember him receiving the Ezil Prize for his book on investment arbitration some years ago, so I'm very happy now to be able to welcome him at the Institute. And then he will be commented, if I can, or discussed by Professor Olivares from the Queen's Mary University. And so I will give them the floor immediately. Won't forget before to thank again the staff of the Institute for the efficiency and the kindness of the preparation of this lecture. And of course, Enoch Asmelash and Alain Zamaria for having put together this lecture series, which turns out to be a very successful program. So, Michael, you have the floor.
Thank you very much indeed for this very kind introduction, and above all for the invitation to take part alongside so many distinguished colleagues working on sovereign debt in this lecture series to Professor Ruiz Fabri and Professor Hess. I'm delighted to be here for the first time, and I hope there will be ways of collaborating further in the future. So my subject today is investment arbitration as a means of resolving sovereign debt disputes. Now, I'm going to suggest, at least in my view, that investment arbitration has a very limited role to play in resolving sovereign debt disputes. So in some sense, this title comes with that very important caveat. I do not fundamentally believe that investment arbitration can contribute very much, if at all, to the successful resolution of sovereign debt crises. On the contrary, in my view, investment arbitration is a potential threat to successful sovereign debt restructuring. As I will explain, it is at least potentially a new way for non-participating creditors to hold up bond exchanges and to complicate the resolution of sovereign debt crises. So here is an outline of what I would like to discuss with you today, and I very much look forward to hearing the comments of Professor Olivares-Caminal, and thank you very much for agreeing to be the commentator today. First of all, I want to highlight what the stakes are in investor-state arbitration arising out of sovereign bonds, focusing particularly on the International Center for the Settlement of Investment Disputes. I would then want to take a closer look at both the jurisdictional phase of sovereign debt adjudication before investor-state arbitral tribunals, focusing on the question of whether sovereign bonds qualify as an investment. And we've had four investor-state arbitrations to date arising out of sovereign bonds, and all of these cases have only reached the jurisdictional phase. But there are, of course, also very interesting questions that would arise in the merits phase and also in the quantum or compensation phase of investor-state arbitrations. And I also want to touch on these two phases. And finally, I want to say something about what the policy implications of investor-state arbitration are paying particular attention to the international community's collective action policy that you've already heard about earlier in this series in the form of collective action clauses elaborated by private sector institutions and international organizations. Now, if we look at sovereign debt restructurings since the Latin American debt crisis in the 1980s, we've seen the rise of holdout litigation, or perhaps put somewhat more in less negative terms, of litigation by non-participating creditors before national courts. Now, commentators, policymakers, and academics disagree to what extent this is really a first-order concern in the world of sovereign debt restructurings. Is there, in fact, all that much sovereign debt litigation in national courts, and is it a fundamental threat to sovereign debt restructurings? If we look, for example, at the case of Argentina and the litigation in New York, that does suggest that at least in some cases, litigation by non-participating creditors can involve significant constraints for the debtor country in carrying out a debt restructuring. But perhaps, and that is certainly the view of some commentators, Argentina was simply an exceptional case, and we cannot extrapolate from that case. Now, my focus today is on the international level, namely on whether investor state arbitration may be a new avenue of choice for holders of bonds who do not, for one reason or another, wish to participate in sovereign debt restructurings. And we have two very high-profile cases, and you've heard of them briefly before, I believe, early in this lecture series. One against Argentina, the Bicara arbitration, the first mass claim in the history of ICSID, where we initially had more than 170,000 Italian nationals that jointly, in the context of a single investor state arbitration, requested more than $5 billion in compensation from Argentina. And more recently, the Pustova Banka case against Greece, arising out of the Greek sovereign debt crisis in 2010 to 2012. And I will come back to both these cases in more detail later on in today's lecture. But what these two cases highlight and the attention they have received, including in the policymaking community, such as the International Monetary Fund, in the context of the Bicara, in respect of the Bicara arbitration in Argentina, and in respect of the Greek sovereign debt crisis for Prestova Banka in the European institutions, is that investor state arbitration is something now to be reckoned with. It is a factor that policymakers need to take into account when designing sovereign debt restructurings. And I'll come back to the question of whether or not investor state arbitration arising out of sovereign bonds has much bite. And that, of course, is a very important question for assessing the extent to which investor state arbitration is ultimately a threat to the successful restructuring of sovereign debt obligations. Now, a few introductory remarks on the Argentine and Greek sovereign debt restructurings. And this is important background for the discussion of the two cases, in focusing in particular on the Avoclat and the Pustova Banka arbitration. Now, as most of you probably know, Argentina carried out two sovereign debt restructurings, one in 2005 and one in 2010. In the first debt restructuring in 2005 in relation to its 2001 default, Argentina achieved a participation rate of 76%. That is, 76% of bondholders chose to voluntarily participate in the bond exchange launched by Argentina. In 2010, Argentina carried out a second restructuring that took the participation rate in total to above 90%. Now, the way that sovereign debt restructurings using bond exchanges work is that it's critical for the sovereign to provide a mix of carrots and sticks to creditors, because they ultimately have to agree to voluntarily give up some of their existing legal entitlements. So there is always going to be a degree of coercion involved in these sovereign debt restructurings. The question is how much coercion and when does that become legally problematic. In the case of Argentina, Argentina enacted a famous law, the lockout law, that prohibited the Argentinian executive from reopening the exchange or settling with non-participating bondholders. So the idea was that the executive, that the parliament of Argentina binds the hands of the executive to make the first exchange offer in 2005 credible. Credible in the sense that creditors would know that if they did not participate in this debt restructuring, they would likely not be paid, and there wouldn't be a better settlement or another settlement further down the line. There are various ways of measuring investor losses, and I use investor here in the sense of someone who buys a sovereign bond, but that doesn't necessarily mean, and I'll come back to that, that these holders of bonds are investors for purposes of investment treaties, that they have investments for purposes of investment treaties. So there are various ways of measuring the size of investor losses, and you've heard about that, I believe, earlier in the lecture series as well. What is characteristic of both the Argentine and the Greek restructuring is that the extent of investor losses was very significant. If one uses the general measure of haircut preferred by financial market participants, that is the face value of the bonds minus the net present value, there was a haircut of almost 80% in the case of Argentina, and not much less in the case of Greece. So both have been very painful restructuring episodes for the bondholders involved. In the case of Greece, a very important difference, and I will come back to that, between the Greek restructuring and the Argentine restructuring is the governing law. For the most part, Argentinian debt was governed by external debt, by external law, chiefly the law of New York, and subject to the jurisdiction of external courts. In the case of Greece, more than 4/5 of the debt of Greece was governed by Greek law and subject to the jurisdiction of Greek courts. Now, that gave Greece more legislative leeway, at least in theory, to directly modify the sovereign bonds in question. So Greece could have legislated to modify the bonds directly, but ultimately didn't choose to do so. Instead, it came up with law 4050 of 2012 that retrofitted collective action clauses onto covered Greek bonds, and it covered the vast majority of outstanding Greek government bonds. And then a qualified majority of 2/3 of all holders would be able to change payment terms of these bonds. the Greek invitation memorandum that launched the bond exchange said that this was a purely voluntary bond exchange in which bondholders were invited to participate. But the Greek law 4050 was clearly part of a strategy of providing a carrot and stick for bondholders to participate in this restructuring, because there was the threat bondholders were put on notice that the government might use these now included majority amendment clauses in these bonds. Now, one difference, and I'm going to come back to that difference too, between the Argentinian and the Greek debt restructuring has to do with whether we are in a default scenario. So Argentina defaulted at the end of 2001, defaulted in the it stopped paying its outstanding external indebtedness, and this triggered an event of default under the bonds. This did not happen in the case of Greece. So Greece did not default on its outstanding indebtedness, but it carried out a restructuring prior. It got very close to a default, but it carried out this restructuring prior to an actual default. Now, let me then come to investor-state arbitration very, very briefly, because I think you will all be familiar, at least with the basics. The International Center for the Settlement of Investment Disputes, or ICSID, was for more than three decades, that is from 1965 when it was created, until the beginning of the 1990s, an obscure organization that few had ever heard of. But it is an autonomous organization, one of the four constitutive organizations of the World Bank Group. And its founding aim has been to contribute to a stable and positive investment climate by offering a set of procedural rules for investor-state arbitration. Now, it's important to emphasize that it's purely a procedural toolkit. And in particular, we don't have any substantive investment protection standards contained within the ICSID Convention. These are to be found either in an investment treaty or in, much less commonly, in customary international law. And we also need the consent of both the investor and the host state to the ICSID arbitration, and that there are three modalities by which such consent can be provided. And most commonly nowadays is a bilateral investment treaty that contains the advance consent of the investor to arbitration. Less common, but by no means rare, is consent, advance consent contained in domestic legislation or simple contractual consent to arbitrate. What is characteristic of ICSID arbitration is that we have typically three arbitrators that sit on these tribunals. They're appointed for a particular dispute. Their terms end once that dispute is resolved, and there is only a very limited possibility of appeal in the form of an annulment. And we'll see an example of that when we take a closer look at the Postava Banca arbitration. Now, let me turn then to the jurisdictional question, namely, are sovereign bonds investments? Now, this question has occupied all the four ICSID tribunals that have considered a bond investor-state arbitrations arising out of sovereign bonds. They've spent a lot of ink on this question. I'm going to first set out my own view on this question, and then take a closer look at the Abaklat award and the Postova Banka Award in particular. And I focus on ICSID arbitration, but of course, there may also be other arbitral rules to which there is consent in an investment treaty, such as uncertural arbitration rules. But my focus here is on ICSID arbitration. Now, the very well-known Article 25 of the ICSID Convention contains a brief statement on subject matter jurisdiction of ICSID tribunals. And that is, an ICSID tribunal has subject matter jurisdiction with respect to legal disputes arising directly out of an investment. So far, so good, but of course, one of the key difficulties that has arisen in ICSID arbitration more generally, beyond the specific context of sovereign bonds, is what is an investment for purposes of Article 25. Against the background of Article 25, or the ICSID Convention, not defining this notion of an investment. So this has been a very fertile territory for arguments for both states and investors. And it's important to emphasize, by way of background, that for the first three decades or so of, or really the first four decades of ICSID existence as an institution, this wasn't really much of an issue, because the consent to arbitrate was typically contained in an investor-state contract. And if you had consent to ICSID arbitration, that generally settled the question. The question became a much more important question once the consent to arbitration became one step removed from the alleged investment, that is, with the rise of investment treaties. So, according to one view, and I'm an adherent of that view, what is required in ICSID arbitration is a so-called double review for jurisdiction. So we need to have an investment under the bilateral investment treaty concerned, such as the Italy-Argentina BIT that was the underlying instrument of consent in the Avoclet arbitration. And we also need to have an investment for purposes of Article 25. In other words, it is not left entirely to the two states parties to the investment treaty to define what an investment is. There are certain objective characteristics of investments that need to be present for the jurisdiction of an ICSID tribunal to be engaged. It is not, in other words, possible for the two parties to an investment treaty to agree that anything and everything counts as an investment. Why is that? Well, I think one reason for that is that the ICSID Convention is a multilateral instrument that provides significant enforcement advantages across all member states of ICSID. And against that background, we cannot take the silence, the absence of a definition of an investment in the ICSID Convention as indicating that there are no limits to what is covered by ICSID subject matter jurisdiction. Now we can, and that's of course a familiar technique in public international law, we can look at the travaux. What did the delegates say during the course of the elaboration on the convention on the meaning of an investment? But like in many other cases, this is not a particularly illuminating exercise, because there was back and forth between the delegates. They couldn't agree on this question, and that was ultimately one of the major reasons why we do not find any definition of investment in the ICSID Convention. So there was disagreement in general about whether to include a definition in the convention, and more importantly, what that definition should be. And there was also, much more specifically, a disagreement among delegates as to whether sovereign bonds or loans would be would fall within the jurisdiction of ICSID tribunals, whether they would qualify as an investment. So you have some delegates saying, yes, sovereign bonds qualify, other delegates saying, no, it does not qualify. This is not the kind of a transaction that we have in mind as an investment. What we have in mind as an investment is a traditional foreign direct investment, not the purchase of some financial market instrument that can be traded on international exchanges. And part of the difficulty arises because if we think about investment in ordinary usage, of course, that is an extremely broad term. Right? So if you speak to financial market participants, they think about investment as virtually any type of asset that you can acquire in the hope of some gain further down the line. It can be gold coins, it can be resources, it can be currencies, etc. But of course, that isn't necessarily, at least in my view, the kind of investment definition that the ICSID Convention has in mind. Some tribunals, starting with the Salini Tribunal, have developed this notion of the objective core of ICSID jurisdiction. So the idea that there is some multilateral meaning to the term investment and that that cannot be set aside, at least not completely, by the parties to an investment treaty. And in this context, the famous criteria that are often mentioned are a positive impact on development. So does a particular transaction involve a contribution to the economic development of the host country? Now that's, in practice, a criterion that is very hard to operationalize, and some tribunals have said as much. It is perhaps easier to operationalize criteria that are typically present when we have such a contribution to economic development, such as the long-term character of a particular transaction. If it is over a period of 20 years, that makes it much more likely that it will have a positive impact on the host country's development, as opposed to a transaction that has a duration of 6 months. Another criterion is that there needs to be some sharing of commercial risk. Sharing of risk, and there is some disagreement about what exactly this criterion means. Now, in one view, of course, sovereign bonds are inherently characterized by risk. There is always, at least if one looks at the annals of sovereign finance, a not insignificant risk of sovereign default at some point in time. Political risk that can ultimately result in the sovereign not repaying its debts in full. So if that's the kind of risk that is meant by this criterion, then sovereign bonds clearly satisfy it. But on another view, and that's my view, what is meant here is really sharing of some commercial risk. There needs to be some commercial undertaking, and that commercial undertaking succeeds or fails, and the investors' returns depend on that success or failure. You invest in a mine, you don't know what the prospects are at that point in time, so this can be could be a tremendous success in 10 years' time, or it could be a colossal failure, or anything in between. Another criterion is, and I think this is particularly important in the context of sovereign bonds is the requirement for a territorial link to the host country. So typically, with foreign direct investment, this is straightforward. You have an investment in the territory of the country concerned. But where do we locate financial market instruments generally and sovereign bonds in particular? Particularly if we think, as in the case of Argentina, about sovereign bonds subject to external law, governed, subject to the jurisdiction of external courts, payable abroad, can we really say that these bonds are an investment in the territory of the country concerned? Well, I certainly have some questions about that. And these concerns were shared by arbitrator Abisab in the Abaklat, in his dissenting opinion in the Abaklat arbitration. And finally, this is not an element that has been typically discussed in the context of the Salini criteria, is that we need to have an association with a commercial undertaking in the host country. So if you buy a corporate bond, for example, then by definition, there's a close link with a commercial undertaking, namely what the corporate purposes that that corporation pursues. But in my view, sovereign bonds are different. They're issued by states for general budgetary purposes, partly to refinance existing borrowing, but also for investment, public expenditure, etc. But without any specific purpose. They're very flexible and fungible. The proceeds are fungible. And I think, hence, the essential association with a commercial undertaking is lacking. So for that reason, I think there are serious doubts about whether sovereign bonds generally qualify as an investment for purposes of Article 25 of the ICSID Convention. What about bilateral investment treaties? So the second step in this double review for jurisdiction. Now, at one level, investment definitions in bilateral investment treaties are surprisingly similar. Many modern investment treaties adopt a broad-based asset-backed definition of investment. They have a general clause, sometimes circular, followed by an illustrative list of what qualifies as an investment, such as intellectual property rights, real estate, and in some cases, loans. But at another level, and this is something that the Pestova Banca Tribunal, as we will see in a few minutes, paid a lot of attention to, there is also very significant variation in how investment definitions are phrased. So if we look at the Argentina-Italy bilateral investment treaty, the one that was the instrument on the basis of which the Italian bondholders brought investor-state arbitrations against Argentina, this bilateral investment treaty refers explicitly to debentures, private or public bonds, or any other rights connected to services or performance having an economic value and capitalized income. So here we have an express inclusion of bonds, including specifically a reference to public bonds. Contrast that with the Argentina-US bilateral investment treaty that simply refers to claims to money or a claim to performance, having economic value associated with an investment. So I think if we look at the Argentina-US BIT, for example, that BIT seems to encapsulate this idea that we need to have an association with a commercial undertaking. It is not enough that there is some freestanding claim to performance that has some economic value. It needs to be associated with an investment in its own right. In other words, a simple claim to money unrelated to any other investment is not by itself an investment. So if we have such a bilateral investment treaty, in my view at least, it would be very difficult to argue, purely in terms of the bilateral investment treaty, that we have a qualifying investment. But as mentioned, if we adopt the view that there is a requirement for an investment also under Article 25, the mere fact that a transaction qualifies as an investment under the bilateral investment treaty is not enough. There is some objective core of ICSID jurisdiction, subject matter jurisdiction. Now, before coming to the Abaklat and Postova Banka arbitrations, I want to briefly highlight an early ICSID arbitration that has some important parallels, particularly, I think, with the Postova Banka arbitration. And that is the FedEx case. Now, FedEx involved promissory notes governed by domestic law, in that case, the law of Venezuela. And the tribunal in that case adopted a wide definition of an investment and found that these promissory notes qualified as an investment under the investment treaty, and that an ICSID tribunal had subject matter jurisdiction under Article 25 with respect to such promissory notes. And I think if we think about, and I will come back to that very shortly, if we think about the Abaklat and Argentina case in particular, there are some important distinguishing factors that distinguish FedEx from Abaklat. And they have essentially to do with the governing law. In FedEx, as mentioned, we have a domestic governing law. These promissory notes are subject to the law of Venezuela. Dispute settlement is before the domestic courts. Whereas in the case of Abaklat and with other external sovereign bonds, they are routinely submitted to the governing law of an important financial center, New York, England, London, and subject to the courts in these jurisdictions, and there are waivers of immunities, both from jurisdiction and from execution. For at least 25 years, courts in these two important financial centers for sovereign finance have qualified sovereign bonds issued under external law, subject to the jurisdiction of external courts, as commercial transactions. The Argentina and Veltover judgment of the US Supreme Court, for example, adopted precisely that conclusion. In my view, the FedEx Tribunal also decided on the facts wrongly. I think the FedEx Tribunal adopted an unduly wide definition of an investment. There is little authority for such a wide definition. There was no connection to ICSID arbitration. In fact, nobody envisaged ICSID arbitration who bought these promissory notes. What I think is another important distinguishing feature between, say, the promissory notes in FedEx and the typical investment dispute reaching investor-state tribunals is that the holders of external bonds, they are guaranteed access to an impartial forum, say the courts of New York or London, whereas that's often not the case with typical foreign investment disputes. I'll come back to that, but I think the FedEx case is more closely analogous to the Postova Banka award, where the instruments were governed by Greek law, than to the Argentina cases arising out of sovereign bonds. Now that brings me to my two main arbitrations. That is, first, the three Argentina arbitrations arising out of sovereign bonds, Abaclat, Ambiente Oficio, and Alemani. Here you see two influential members of the Global Committee of Argentina Bondholders, Hans Humes and Nicola Stock. So they played a very important role in this committee that had formed after Argentina's sovereign default. And the Global Committee of Argentina Bondholders played a very important role behind the scenes, certainly, of the launching of the Abaclat arbitration. Now, the Abaclat arbitration, we have for the very first time, and this caused considerable difficulties, not just jurisdictional, but also procedural, a mass claim. More than 150,000 bondholders bringing a single investor state arbitration against Argentina. Argentina raised a whole host of objections, procedural and jurisdictional, relating to the alleged violation of its due process rights. That given the bundling of so many different bonds bought at different times, subject to somewhat different terms and conditions in some cases, etc., it would be impossible for the tribunal to individually consider each individual claimant, and that therefore it couldn't be possible, it should not be possible for the claimants to bundle all these claims in a single arbitration. Now, the majority of the tribunal famously dismissed all of Argentina's jurisdictional objections, including its objections regarding the propriety of including Argentina's allegation that it was not proper for an ICSID tribunal to consider a mass claims for the reasons mentioned, and characterize these as questions that may come into play when the tribunal would, in the merits phase, consider questions of admissibility. But in jurisdictional terms, very importantly, the Abaclat tribunal, examining closely the Argentina-Italy BIT that we saw before, that specifically includes a reference to the inclusion of sovereign bonds, found no difficulty in the notion that a sovereign bond governed by an external law, subject to the jurisdiction of external courts, qualifies as an investment for purposes of the bilateral investment treaty, and it saw no need to undertake a separate inquiry into whether or not the bonds in question qualified as an investment for purposes of Article 25. So it was sufficient that the instrument of consent, the BIT, expressly included sovereign bonds. And as to the argument of Argentina, that there was no link with the territory of Argentina, so an objection as to the territorial jurisdiction of the tribunal, the tribunal also concluded that there was no merit in that contention, similar to the FedEx tribunal earlier. Ultimately, the tribunal explained the proceeds of these bonds were made available to Argentina for purposes relating to the governance of Argentina, and that was sufficient to meet any territorial link requirement under the bilateral investment treaty in question. Now, there are some variations that in the Ambiente Oficio and Alemani cases. I don't have time to go into these now, but in terms of the basic conclusions. That is, ICSE tribunals have jurisdiction in respect of sovereign bonds governed by an external law. Both tribunals, and they came after the Avoclet tribunal, agreed with the first tribunal. They were less complicated in procedural terms because these two tribunals had far fewer claimants than the Avoclet tribunal. Now, as mentioned, none of these three cases, despite the tribunal upholding these tribunals upholding their jurisdiction, has ever reached the merits phase. Why not? Well, because these three arbitrations ultimately settled when President Macri came to power. So if we look at the Avoclet award, that arbitration settled. I mean, the details are not public, but the basic financial terms of that settlement can be gleaned from public sources. The settlement essentially provided for 150% of the bond's nominal value. Now, recall that this is almost 15 years after Argentina defaulted and 5 years after the Avoclet's award on jurisdiction. So that we have a substantial period of time has elapsed. Now, whether or not that is a good, a generous settlement, or a poor settlement depends very much on the circumstances under which the bondholders have acquired their bonds. Have they acquired, for example, substantially below par, or in which case it was probably quite a good settlement, or have they acquired at par, in which case this was not a particularly satisfying settlement for the bondholders concerned. So that's the three Argentina cases. That brings me now to more recently the Pushtova Banka and Istro Capital arbitration against Greece. Now this is the second set of it's the second sovereign debt crisis that has given rise to an ICSID arbitration arising out of sovereign bonds, in this case Greek government bonds governed by Greek law. Pushtova Banka is a Slovak bank that bought Greek government bonds first between January and April 2010, and these dates are important because at least they seem to have been important to the tribunal, because they bought at a time when it was already apparent that Greece was likely to experience substantial difficulties in servicing its bonds at some point. And in fact, Pushtova Banka sold the bonds it acquired in early 2010 in the course of 2011, when Greece's financial difficulties intensified, and it bought other bonds back, presumably for significantly lower prices on the secondary market. When Greece launched its bond exchange in February 2012, Pushtova Banka did not participate in that offer. So the board of the bank refused to tender its bonds. So that's the key facts that gave rise to this ICSID arbitration. Now, very surprisingly, I think for almost all observers, including probably Greece and its lawyers themselves, the tribunal reached an entirely opposite conclusion to the three Argentina tribunals, namely that an ICSID tribunal lacks subject matter jurisdiction over sovereign bonds, and that therefore it could not proceed to examine the merits of Pushtova Banka's arguments. Why did the tribunal find that it lacked subject matter jurisdiction over sovereign bonds. Well, the tribunal paid very close attention to the language of the bilateral investment treaty, and it said that the language was significantly different in case of the Slovak-Greek BIT and the Cyprus-Greek BITs, the two BITs that were at issue in the Poslova Banka arbitration, as compared to the Italy-Argentina BIT in the three Argentina arbitrations. Specifically, there was no express mention of private and public debentures in these two BITs. So the definition of investment was significantly narrower, according to the tribunal, than in the three Argentina arbitrations. The tribunal also explained at some length that sovereign debt had special characteristics, that it was an important instrument of monetary policy, and that there were no precedents apart from the three Argentina cases for ICSID tribunals to exercise jurisdiction over such disputes. And therefore, it concluded no jurisdiction. Poslova Banka sought an annulment of that award, and perhaps also, somewhat surprisingly, a unanimous ad hoc annulment panel found that Poslova Banka's key allegation in the annulment phase, namely that the arbitral tribunal had failed to state the reasons for its award, the tribunal found that this allegation was unfounded, and it rejected the annulment request by the bondholders. So much for the jurisdictional phase of investment treaty arbitrations arising out of sovereign bonds. Now, very briefly, what about the merits? And I think, certainly from an academic point of view, here there would be some very interesting questions that would arise. And holding all else equal, in my view, both in the three Argentina arbitrations and in the Greek arbitration, in particular in Poslova Banka, the bondholders would have had certainly a reasonably strong case. They would have perhaps managed to show that there had been a breach of one or other investment treaty protection standards in the applicable bilateral investment treaty. And the two standards that come to mind first and foremost are expropriation. If we consider particularly the legislative interventions, both by Argentina and by Greece with the retrofitting of collective action clauses. Now, the threshold for expropriation can be significant, so it can be difficult for a claimant to show that an expropriation has occurred. But if that is no avenue to success, then perhaps fair and equitable treatment is a more likely avenue for bondholders. And I think particularly if we think about the Greek debt restructuring, this retroactive insertion of collective action clauses and about the exemption on the eve of the restructuring of the European Central Bank from the restructuring, bondholders in principle would have a reasonably strong claim on the merits against Greece. So Greece was perhaps lucky that on jurisdictional grounds the tribunal found that it could not proceed further with this case. In terms of non-discrimination, which of course we also find both in the form of national treatment and most favored nation treatment, I suspect bondholders would generally have a very difficult time making out a showing of either standard, because we typically do not have any discrimination by nationality, certainly not direct, but almost very difficult to show even indirect discrimination by nationality in modern sovereign debt restructurings. very briefly, one major question that would also arise if we have investor state arbitrations arising out of sovereign bonds that proceed to the quantum phase is, well, how much compensation should be paid? And here the question is, well, would bondholders be entitled in all cases to the full nominal value of the bonds that they hold, or might tribunals be prepared in some circumstances to not allow bondholders to recover more than what they paid on the secondary market for these bonds? And tribunals might be influenced in that assessment of the amount of compensation due by what the legitimate expectations of the purchasers of the sovereign bonds were, taking into account the full circumstances of the acquisition of the sovereign bonds in question. And also, they might be influenced by the view that bilateral investment treaties are not designed to provide insurance to holders of sovereign bonds against general default risk. And here I've got a quote from an earlier author on sovereign debt, Ernst Feichenfeld, who wrote in the interwar period, after we've seen a wave of sovereign defaults following the Great Depression, who said, "International law will guarantee the creditor the existence of a debt and of a debtor, but not the existence of a good debt or a rich debtor." I think that conclusion still stands. International law, even after the investment treaty revolution, does not guarantee full repayment of sovereign bonds, and it shouldn't guarantee full repayment of sovereign bonds in all circumstances. Why? Well, one reason is that investor-state arbitration might otherwise pose a potentially serious threat to the collective action policy that has become an important feature of the crisis resolution arsenal of the international community. So a non-participating bondholder might be able to claim that even though collective action clauses have been used by a supermajority of bondholders, that the restructuring still violated one or other of the BIT's treatment standards, and that would blow potentially a very significant hole into the international community's collective action policy. So now one way of addressing this, and you've heard about this earlier in the lectures by Professor Odit and Bismuth, are negotiated restructuring annexes. So we see the phenomenon in some recent investment treaties that these investment treaties include an annex that essentially says, if you carry out a market-based sovereign debt restructuring, that is a negotiated restructuring, and that's defined in the annex, then you are limited to very specific treatment claims. In particular, you cannot bring a claim for breach of fair and equitable treatment or for expropriation. Now, these negotiated restructuring annexes haven't really been tested thus far, but I would think that they are going to be effective. But of course, they are not, for the time being, found in the great majority of investment treaties, and that's going to be the case for the foreseeable future. So we still have a potentially significant risk of investor-state arbitration under the great majority of investment treaties that lack such a negotiated restructuring annex. So to sum up, we've seen, if we compare the three Argentina arbitrations and the Greek arbitration, considerable divergence in how investor-state tribunals have approached claims arising out of sovereign bonds. None of them has proceeded to the merits phase, but for different reasons. In the Argentina cases, because there was ultimately a settlement after a decade on the arbitration going through the jurisdictional phase in the Abaklat arbitration, and very importantly in the Postova Bank arbitration, because the tribunal, in striking departure, and to the surprise of virtually everyone, concluded that it lacked jurisdiction over sovereign bonds. So it was, I think, that the Prestova Banca Tribunal was very much aware of what the possible implications would be of investor-state tribunals assuming jurisdiction over sovereign bonds in the absence of an explicit consent by the host state to the inclusion of such bonds. No consent. If there is no consent to such arbitration, it would be particularly problematic for an investor tribunal to exercise its jurisdiction. And the tribunal might have also been aware, and if one looks at the award, in part, these policy considerations seem to have influenced the tribunal about what the implications would be for the sovereign debt market. Here I've got a quote, and that's my concluding slide, from a mixed claims commission in at the end of the 19th century, which, in a case arising out of sovereign bonds at that time, a Mexican sovereign bond, said, the disturbance which would ensue in the administration, credit, and relation of modern nations if claims on the account of the public debt were made the matter of international claims has long been understood. Now, I've suggested that the Postova Banca Tribunal has been much more attuned to these concerns than the Argentina tribunals, and we will see how future tribunals deal with this question. We're bound to see in the next 10 to 20 years additional investor-state arbitrations, or at least attempts to use investor-state arbitrations to obtain full recovery on sovereign bonds, which could potentially, as I've suggested, undermine sovereign debt crisis resolution. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to start thanking the Max Planck Institute for Procedural Law for inviting us, and particularly me, to discuss Michael's fascinating presentation. And I would also like to personally thank Professor Ruiz Fabri and Professor Hess for the invitation. And basically, a big congratulations to Michael for his tour de force on sovereign arbitration. Michael definitely is one of the leading experts on sovereign arbitration. And I would like to start with some very brief general comments on the subject matter. And then I will provide my own views on the whole issue on what the procedure and how things should be followed from here onwards. I agree with Michael in the sense that he started by saying investment arbitration has a limited role, and also that arbitration is a threat that can complicate resolution. For me, the issue that there has only been four cases and all those cases have only reached the jurisdictional phase, that already is a big threat, and that already is an issue that puts a lot of uncertainty in an area of international finance. Particularly then when we look at some of the time frame that has elapsed through this litigation, so these arbitral procedures. Basically, Michael pointed that the Becara case started in 2006, and this was settled in 2016. So that means 10 years of uncertainty for investors as to what would happen with an actual investment. And that, from the point of view of investors in the financial markets, that's a serious threat. I'm also very conscious, and this kind of strength is the point that I want to make, that both Becara and Postova, and Becara with the subset of Abaklat, basically these cases should be taken into account in policy design, because we know now that there's an additional fora that can eventually be used in the case or in the context of sovereign debt. I personally take a wider view from that adopted by Michael in regard to whether sovereign investments can fall under either both BITs or Article 25 of the ICSID Convention. And basically, for me, the view that basically bonds, whether they are governed by a different governing law, whether they are issued in a different jurisdiction, whether litigation or the governing law of the instruments and the jurisdiction will be New York, England, and Wales, that's, in my personal view, that's irrelevant, because basically the money that is raised through the issuance will benefit the country. I basically think that basically it is a commercial undertaking, even if it's for general budgetary purposes, even if it's for a refinancing itself, I see that as a commercial undertaking. And I personally think that even if we take the narrow definition of the US-Argentina bilateral investment treaty, basically, Michael, correct me if I'm wrong, but basically I think it's like a claim to performance having economic value associated with an investment. I claim that this can be seen as an investment, and it definitely has an economic value. And even though it will be used for general financing purposes, or even if it's for a restructuring, what you are doing is you are investing in the future of the country. And that per se will, in my broad view or my broad take on arbitration, will already suffice for purposes of jurisdiction. And then the issue that there has been a settlement, that to a certain extent, I don't know whether that attests to the limitation of the process in itself. And I personally think that 10 years without having entered into the substance itself, that's something that undermines the position of investors. I think that that creates a lot of uncertainty, and this uncertainty translates into an weakening of the financial instruments themselves. On the Postova decision, I'm not going to enter into substance because, oh, sorry, on the jurisdictional issue, because I kind of indirectly address that looking at Argentina, but basically on the substance, I personally think that considering that there are instruments of monetary policy, I do not fully agree with that view or that position of that tribunal, in the sense that when a sovereign issues sovereign debt, they do this in a commercial nature. And again, that was already being confirmed by a case that Michael mentioned, which is the Veltover versus Argentina. It's a case from the US Supreme Court from 1992. And on top of that, then we have the different state immunity acts, which confirm that when you act on us in a commercial capacity, you are acting as a private individual and not as a sovereign, and therefore you do not enjoy sovereign immunity. One thing that I would like to point out in the Argentine case, eventually, if it would have gone to the substantial stage, is that basically when Argentina launched the exchange, Argentina did that and created a more favorable regime for some of the debt holders. Namely, the Argentine proposal, basically, there were two rounds of proposals, there were two terms, basically the Dubai terms and the Buenos Aires terms, and in the designing of the restructuring offer, Argentina made beneficial concessions to Argentine-based pension funds who took part in the restructuring, and they accepted on a 100% degree of participation. So that already clears, or in my personal view, I think that even if these would have moved into the substance, I think that they would have been substantial grounds, and that's something that should definitely be looked further. But in any event, the point that I'm trying to make, and that's what I'm going to try to do with my short presentation, is that basically, if we have reached the stage of some sort of dispute resolution mechanism, either be that arbitration or litigation, that means that we have failed in the procedural design of the debt instruments. And I will start with a disclaimer. Basically, due to time constraint, I will just like to ignite a discussion, and I'm going to focus at the macro level. I'm not going to get into the procedural issues at the UK or US law level. And finally, opinions are personal, and I will put emphasis on this because I've been personally involved in the Greek restructuring. I've been involved in the Argentine restructuring. I have worked with international organizations, and I am currently involved in another sovereign debt restructuring. So I want to stress that all opinions are personal. Having said that, I'm going to be very candid because I am an Argentine myself. I have outlived a couple of crises, and most likely I will face another one. Having said that, let me start with two general statements. One is, when we are dealing with sovereign debt, sometimes this defies what we perceive as logic, because it encompasses not just legal issues, if we are looking at it from a legal perspective, or not just financial or economic issues, if we are looking at it from an economic financial discipline. The issue is that when we are dealing with sovereign debt, we are dealing with a multitude of aspects, mainly legal, economic, financial, political, and social. And this is quite evident in how we dealt with the Greek crisis in Europe. The other issue that I would like to highlight or stress is that basically, when we are dealing with sovereign debt, it is an overlapping structure where we are faced with multilateral lending, bilateral lending, and private lending. And these three big groups of debt need to be looked at from the borrower's perspective, from the lender's perspective, and also we need to take into account an ex-ante and an ex-post analysis, because this opens many other dimensions as to whether the debt is legitimate, whether the debt should be repaid, whether the debt served its purpose, etc., which many times is an issue which opens avenues for litigation. Getting slightly more technical, and again, I'm just trying to convey a broad picture. I don't want to get into the details, but if we looked at the previous slide in more detail, what we can talk about is basically, even we have multilateral, bilateral lending, and then the private sector can be divided into commercial bank debt, private sector debt issued through Eurobonds, and trade credits. Each one of these will perform kind of a different function, in the sense that basically multilateral will provide new financing in exchange of conditionality. Bilateral, it will be a process of coordination where the parties will negotiate a favorable outcome. On the commercial bank debt, basically this will be creditor committees negotiating with the debtor. This is what is known as the London Club approach, and this will be done on an ad hoc basis. On the private sector, on the Eurobond holders, usually it's a consultation with creditors, which usually ends in an exchange offer. And then trade credits, which usually it's consultation and usually either time extensions, or they are usually exempt from any restructuring. And these are, at the top end, the creditors, and at the bottom, the debtor. And in between is what happens and which shape or form a restructuring will take place. So, bottom line, this brings us to an issue as to whether shall we follow the ad hoc market-oriented contractual approach of entering into a voluntarily restructuring, which could be preemptive prior to the actual crisis or default, or which usually will take the form of a reprofiling or afterward, which will take the form of an actual restructuring after an event of default. Or we will go into a dispute resolution, either litigation or arbitration scenario, once default has taken place, and how do we sort this out? In order to address that issue, what we need to look at is, and this is kind of a tour de force, and I'm happy to explain any of this in bilateral discussions or during the Q&A, but basically this is kind of the history of sovereign debt restructuring, which we start with some arbitration clauses in Brazil in 1983 and take us through Baker Plan, Brady Plan, Weltover case, then the first restructuring is Russia, Ukraine, Pakistan, Ecuador, who use exit consent, the Elliott case, the year 2000 in Peru, then the SDRM proposed by the IMF, the Argentine restructuring, the insertion of CACs in New York, Uruguay, which was, in my view, the model debt restructuring. Then we have the Aries German repackaging of Paris Club debt, then Belgium, who passed a law to prevent what happened with Elliott and Peru, and then litigation, that's the Paris Club dealing with Iraq and its debt, then some restructurings in the Caribbean, plus then other litigation against Argentina, Donegal versus Zambia, then Ecuador, which created a committee to assess whether that was legitimate or not, a committee which, for example, the head of the legal unit of that committee apparently is not even a lawyer, and basically they claimed that some of these debts were illegal because they were a result of a IMF-sponsored Brady Plan. Some of these things don't deserve even a proper analysis, but then we have Norway who pardoned some of the outstanding debt because they say that it was illegitimate. Okay, what's illegitimate? Either it's legal or illegal, but illegitimate. And that's not clear what it's illegitimate, but they say this is a one-off because it's illegitimate. And then we have other cases of venture litigation. Then Jamaica that did a restructuring in 2010. They were borrowing with an interest rate of 27%, despite the fact that under New York law, more than 25 is considered usury. And then the principles to promote sovereign debt principles, then the EU crisis, then ESM came into the picture, and then basically what would be the future for the EU forward-looking. So if you ask me, as you can tell, there has been some litigation issues. So when we are faced with an actual restructuring with a sovereign in distress, well, we need to ask ourselves whether what are our options? Either we restructure or either accept. Usually, you know that there are mainly three tools to restructure debt. Either a grace period or a delay to pay the debt, a haircut on the interest, that's an interest reduction, or a haircut on principal. Technically, you can claim there are four, one which combines all three of them. Those are the only real options that we have when we are facing a debt restructuring. And usually, creditors are not very keen when you have to tell them, look, guys, I owe you 100, now I'm only going to pay you 50. Needless to say, that would not make them very happy. So what's the option that they are left with? Okay, sue the sovereign. Okay, if we're going to sue the sovereign, where, when, and how? And what we need to bear in mind is whether we can obtain jurisdiction where you have immunity from suit, personal and subject matter jurisdiction, and whether they can benefit from an act of state. And basically, if you can obtain the jurisdiction, most likely you will obtain a federal ruling, mainly if you follow precedent under English law or New York law, when there's a contract where there's a valid legal obligation when you owe money, most likely you will get a federal ruling. However, obtaining a ruling is one thing, but enforcing it, it's a completely different one. And that's when, basically, if you are successful, then you need to enforce your judgment. If you're successful, that's the end of the road, lucky you, but most likely you will be unsuccessful. And a clear example is what has been going on with the litigation with Argentina. After 16 years, the main creditor has been suing Argentina in the US, in more than one state, Florida, Nevada, you name it. New York, of course, Washington, of course. And then they had to go abroad. France, the UK, Switzerland. They were trying to attach reserves of the Central Bank of Argentina with the BIS. They went to Ghana to try to attach one of the boats of the Argentine Navy. They went to Japan. They were suing wherever you think of, even in outer space. They went to try to attach satellites that were being launched by Argentina. Who will be the court officer who will go and attach the satellites on behalf of the creditor? I don't know. I don't know whether they will call an intergalactic force, how they will do that, but there was a serious attempt on that. So basically, the truth is that, as you can tell, this has been going on for 15 years. To be able to litigate in international jurisdictions many times simultaneously, you need to have very broad shoulders. That means you need to be able to support the legal fees associated with that, which usually is not the case for retail creditors. And that's why usually, unless you belong to a special type of creditor, you most likely will end up in a restructuring where you will have to accept an exchange offer, which most likely will include a face value reduction. So, bottom line, if we need to go into a restructuring, this is how I see in one snapshot how to do a restructuring. And the first question that you need to ask yourself, and I'm not going to get into the detail, I'm just trying to convey the macro view, but I'm happy to explain and get into the technicalities if required. Basically, do you have collective action clauses? If yes, okay, which percentage? And then depending on the percentage, you can do this either series by series, or aggregating different series, where we have the single limb CAC, which was designed by the ICMA and endorsed by the IMF, or the European model with the double limb CAC. However, if you don't have CACs, then we move into traditional exchange offers. Give me your old piece of paper, I will give you a new piece of paper with, needless to say, lower interest rates and a face value reduction. Ways to enhance degree of participation, usually exit consent, and some people claim that what we've seen in Greece was a reverse exit consent. Exit consent is a tool that allows you to increase the degree of participation by, how can I put this politely, by, I don't want to use forcing and bending the arm of creditors, but once a sufficient number of creditors have accepted the exchange offer, then you will call for a bondholders meeting to restructure the bond. And therefore, what you're going to do, you're going to strip some of the key clauses of the old bond. Therefore, you render the old piece of bond a useless piece of paper. And this has been used in a couple of occasions, and it is a tool which has facilitated or has increased the degree of participation. If not, and this is where I think that it's important to devise a process, and this is where basically I think that the Institute can engage within its procedural quest in finding ways to enhance contractually the terms of the debt instruments. Why? And again, this is where I link back to how I started, saying if we end up in either litigation or arbitration, I think that probably we have failed. It's a matter of prevention rather than curing a sick patient. And that's why, basically, on the contractual sweeteners, a contractual sweetener is things that you can build into your contracts in order to make them more attractive for creditors. If you're going to launch an exchange offer when you're going to tell them, guys, I want you to happily accept a 50% haircut because you cannot litigate, So your only option left is accept a 50% haircut. At least you need to be able to disguise that nicely for them to come to you and accept the restructuring. And that's why you need to work on your contractual sweeteners. Like, for example, I am never going to offer better terms to anyone else, because if not, you will be entitled to the same better terms. That's the most favored creditor clause of the RUFO clause, rights upon future offers. Or principal reinstatement. You accept today a 30% haircut, a 40% haircut, but if I default again within the next 10 years, that hair that I have just cut, that haircut, will grow again. It's the reinstatement of the principal back on your bond. Prepayment arrangements, that, for example, throughout the 40 years life of the bond, periodically, I will be buying bonds in the secondary market. Why? Why I will be doing this? Because when maturity comes, when I need to do a bullet payment, I will have reduced the outstanding amount of the bond. In theory, that means that it will be more likely that I will be able to repay the bond in full. Or guarantees or the use of collateral or GDP-linked instruments. And basically, this is more or less the text explaining what I was telling you here, basically in the absence of CACs. Then we have all these kind of credit enhancements, the sweeteners, where, for example, some of the latest developments are on the contingent side of things, where basically you have instruments that have built-in pre-shock tools or post-shock tools. And a clear example is Grenada. Grenada has been hit by hurricanes on more than one occasion. And what they have built in now is what is known as a hurricane clause. Therefore, you have bonds. And again, here you can use freely your imagination. Basically, you have a bond, and if it happens that the sovereign is not in a position to repay interest. Why? Because they have just been hit by a hurricane that has destroyed all crops, and basically the main industries in Grenada are coffee beans or tourism, and basically we need to rebuild half of the hotels and we need to plant a crop of coffee afresh. This type of bonds with this type of clauses will allow you to take an interest payment holiday, for example, until the country is up and running again. And these are the kind of things that we need to start being more creative. And for example, the Bank of England is currently working on GDP-linked bonds. And I'm saying, basically, that they will be contingent payments based on performance. And this is a clear example, or at least in my view. Don't worry, I know that you might not be able to see clearly the figures. They were telling me there were some issues with the blue background. The red circle highlights the degree of participation on different exchange offers. These are Ukraine in the year 1999, Ecuador 2000, Pakistan, Uruguay, Argentina, Belize, Greece, and Ukraine 2015. If you look at the degree of participation, basically all of them are above 90%. And I would say 95, 97, 99, 93, 93, 97, 97. And what I'm trying to highlight with this, and I have selected these different restructurings because some of them, the instruments included collective action clauses. On some of them, there were the use of exit consents. In some of them, there were just plain exchange offers. Some of them were prior to default. Some of them were after default. Some of them were with contractual sweeteners. Overall, the outcome is, whichever method you have adopted, the degree of participation has been way above 90%. That is a very high degree of participation, knowing that there's no insolvency tool. If you think that, that litigation is not an option, you already have strong incentives to favor a restructuring. So that's why I think that our next task is to find the right procedure to perfection the contractual terms to better what we have out there. And then this is, I included last minute this slide based on a discussion that I had today over lunch with some of the researchers of the Institute that we were discussing about how to perfection the contractual clauses. And this is an example of the pari passu clause. The pari passu clause is a clause which talks about ranking. It just tells you the bonds rank and will rank equally with each other. That means pari passu. The problem is that nobody really knew what pari passu meant, and everybody started tweaking the clause here and there to try to make slightly more sense of the clause, and that's why we end up with some Frankenstein-like clauses, which are kind of a patch of different bits and pieces. And that's the clause which brought all these 15 years of litigation in New York with Argentina, where we see that it says, the bonds shall rank at all times pari passu and without any preference among themselves. And then the second line, to try to make some sense, they included the payment obligations of the Republic under the security shall at all times rank at least equally. They added the payment obligations. If it's a bond, what type of obligation would it be if it's not payment? I personally think that the payment does not add anything, but just confuses people. That's why, as a result of the outcome of Argentina, we saw the outcome, which is this, a clean version of the clause without referring to pari passu. It says, the bonds constitute direct, unconditional, unsubordinated, and unsecured obligations of the Republic, and the notes rank and will rank equally among themselves, no pari passu, and with all other unsubordinated, unsecured borrowed money of the Republic. And then they added, to avoid any type of confusion, the provision shall not be construed as to require the Republic to pay all items of its indebtedness ratably as they fall due. So they try to prevent an interpretation like the one in Argentina. And this is what I mean. We need to perfection the contracts and find the process, establish how we're going to do this in an orderly manner to push things rather than a top-down, like a cross-border insolvency treaty for sovereigns, which I personally think that we will never be able to achieve, basically a bottoms-up approach where we can make some changes. And here in the middle, sorry, what I left here in the middle is an example of an Italian bond clause, which I personally think it's a bit broad. I'm being recorded, so I'm trying to be politically correct. So what I would like to highlight here is that the debt securities will be direct, unconditional, and unsecured obligations of Italy. Fine. They will rank equally with all our present and future. Fine. And then we have two or three lines of makeup saying we will pledge all the will to repay. They will be paid by the central bank, which is perfectly fine, but doesn't add much to the purpose of the clause. It's just a makeup. But I like the last line. We will pay amounts due on the debt securities equally and ratably with all general loan obligations of Italy. This is what creditors were seeking in the pari passu clause in Argentina. But the clause of Argentina just says rank and will rank. That doesn't have to say, do anything with payment. Here they say, whenever I pay doctors in hospitals, I will pay the bondholders. Whenever I pay the policeman who stands at night in the street to guard our houses, I will pay the bondholders. So that means that if I don't pay the bondholders, I will not be able to pay the salaries of public servants without also allocating part of that payment to the creditors. And I think that that's extremely dangerous. And the problem with the creditor, with this particular clause is that it has been evolving, and there are some interviews conducted to the leading law firms issuing these bonds that say this is some kind of general wisdom that has been transferred from a senior partner to another senior partner. And if they have been there in the instruments for many, many years, there must be a reason. The truth is that basically, except in two circumstances, which there is a specific law that tells you that you can subordinate the rest of the creditors, there's no need to have this clause in the first place in the debt instruments. So basically, again, except Argentina, which I personally think is a complete outlier because they passed a law to formally subordinate creditors, then the amount of litigation has been very limited worldwide. And basically, just to finish, I think that perfect is the enemy of good. And basically, This is a quote from Orlando Pezzetti, which was made very popular by Voltaire. And I brought my friend Voltaire on the slide to give the quote himself. But basically, what we have here is that basically there's no agreement as to what is the real problem. And I think that there are many problems with many champions. And there have been almost 15 years since we started discussing whether we need an international regime for sovereigns. And basically, there's still no agreement. The main issue is the inter-creditor coordination. Basically, IMF, Paris Club, private bondholders, ESM, which is a new kid on the block. And basically, litigation, I personally think it's not an option because the dynamics are completely different due to the special nature of the debtor. And on top of that, the serious limitations that the creditor has. So the dynamics are completely different. And that's why basically contract law is not a panacea, but it's something that can be a bottoms-up approach that can contribute substantially to the enhancement. And there's much more to be done. I think that CACs, collective action clauses, as they have been presented in the previous series, are a great addition, but I don't think that that's the ultimate solution. However, there's a huge one, and one that will contribute considerably for the betterment of sovereign debt restructuring. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much to you. Effectivement, le mieux est l'ennemi du bien. C'est une citation bien connue en français. J'en parlais encore hier avec quelqu'un de l'Institut. So perfect is the enemy of the good, certainly. But we will nevertheless open the floor for questions. And so, do we have some? Yeah.
Just wondering, what is the nationality of a particular creditor? Because it could be advantageous for a creditor to structure himself so as to fall under a bilateral investment protection agreement. Does it depend on whether the nationality of the creditor has existed from the time when he invested until the time of the litigation? Even corporations can change their nationality. A societas europea can be shifted from one territory to another. Could there also be an argument that the nationality of a creditor has been contrived, artificially created, in order for the creditor to fall under a particular bilateral investment protection agreement? Thank you.
So I think, yes, the answer is such arguments could be made and such arguments have been made. So in general, the point in time at which personal jurisdiction is assessed is at the point in time is a time at when the arbitration was brought. So what was the nationality of the claimant at that point in time? But if there is a potentially abusive corporate structuring in the lead up to that, some tribunals may be prepared to take that into account. And we also have in some investment treaties so-called denial of benefits clauses that deny the benefits of the investment treaty to investors that do not, in a nutshell, have any substantial contact have any substantial presence in the jurisdiction concerned. So a mere vehicle, a mere corporate vehicle without any associated activity in the country concerned may not qualify as an investor under some investment treaties.
Michael, can I follow up on that? Because basically, the essence of these financial instruments are that they are freely tradable in the market and they can change hands on a regular basis. If you incorporate a company to sue on an instrument, technically not to sue, and this has already been settled in New York litigation, that basically you buy the instrument to collect, and upon the sovereign not paying, then that opens you the right to sue. But basically you buy the instruments, even if they're in default, you're providing liquidity to the market, and you go to the arbitral tribunal, you see that there's a chance there that your claim will be rejected, and basically that will undermine the essence of the financial instrument itself?
Well, so I think there may be a risk from that perspective. Means there could be such a risk on the sort of on the other side of the coin. One of the concerns with investor-state arbitration on sovereign bonds is precisely that they can be traded at the click of a button, and that nationality therefore can change very, very quickly, and therefore perhaps investor-state arbitration for that reason too is not a particularly suitable mechanism given the fast-moving world of sovereign debt and the easy tradability of these securities.
Thank you very much for these two very inspiring presentations, and also for the two quite different perspectives the two of you took on the same problem. I would like to start by taking up what you said. Well, litigation is not an option. Yeah, what matters are better contractual solutions. I do agree, of course. You can try to improve the wording, the clauses of bonds, and this is something to be made. I was wondering to what extent would these clauses influence the prices to be paid by states trying to get or to raise money on the markets. I could imagine that this might be a problem. And so there might still be an incentive to be a little bit more generous in order to attract creditors. And I would say, nevertheless, litigation will always take place. We cannot avoid it. And then it was quite interesting to see the relationship between civil litigation on the one hand side and investment arbitration on the other hand. And the question was, Mr. Waibel, how to delineate both strands? And I understood you a little bit in the sense that if it goes in the direction commercial activity, then we are rather in the litigation world and we are outside of the investment. So I would like to learn a little bit more whether you see a direct link between these two issues. And you addressed Weltover. Yes, it's a famous and prominent case, and it has been a while. If I take up the latest case of the German Federal Civil Court, which simply said the Greek law is a sovereign act, so Greek is entitled to immunity. And as you know, the Austrian Supreme Civil Court said obviously the opposite and said this is a clear-cut contract and it is a commercial activity. And to take up a last point, also a question to the two of you, don't we have new actors in this kind of disputes? I'm looking at investors in the sense of hedge funds, which might not only be the owners of the bonds, but which might also be behind the actors, behind the scene, able to finance and to hold out for 20 years. 20 years might be a very good investment if you go or enter at a very low price and come up with, let's say, 200% or even 500% gains that you or profits that you make. And in this respect, I think the perspective of these actors might also be very interesting. If you look at process financing, which has become a very interesting area in procedural law, these guys really look at inter different fora and ask, where should I go? How much have I to invest? And they also look at the enforcement stage. And we have seen in the Argentine cases, finally, that enforcement is not only, as you put it, about law. It's also about shaming, putting pressure on the Argentine president who cannot lose any longer his presidential airplane to make a state visit in Germany, something like this. So maybe these actors are a little bit problematic in a general negotiation process?
I will start, Michael, addressing the first and the last question. The first one was about the pricing of the clauses. This is a fear that has always been in the back of the head of issuers. However, it's something which has been long time settled when collective action clauses were introduced for the first time in the year 2003. Issuers were very concerned about how these clauses will be priced or if they will be priced at all. The truth is that basically it didn't have an impact at all on the pricing of the bonds, and that two issuances with these clauses, the first two issuances, which were Mexico and Brazil in 2003, both of them were oversubscribed. If I'm not mistaken, the Mexican issuance was oversubscribed by 700%, and I think that the Brazilian was oversubscribed by 400%. Then in the aftermath, in the pari passu litigation, when we were looking at whether investors have priced the pari passu clause depending on the different wording, that has become something extremely technical that basically, no, it has not been priced. And there are a couple of studies on that as well. The reality is that when we have seen a clear indication where a contractual term made a difference was during the Greek crisis, that some of the English governed bonds, that basically the issuance was small, basically you were able to have a blocking holding. Because if you want to make any restructuring or if you want to trigger the CACs, you need to reach a given percentage. But if you hold a small amount of debt, we're talking about 50 million, 75 million of euros, you were able to block the restructuring and you will be able to be paid in full. And those bonds, yes, those were but they were trading at a premium, but that doesn't mean basically that when the issuance was made that there was a pricing on the issuance because of a particular type of clause. So, bottom line, the short answer is the market has not yet priced correctly the different legal terms within a prospectus. Going to the third one, the new type of players, and you were talking about naming and shaming, and I think that basically one of the first precedents is even before Argentina, there was an African government who the head of state enjoy regular trips to Paris, and they hire private investigators to follow him, and they were getting copies of the receipts of expenses, I mean from shops like Chanel, Louis Vuitton, you name it, plus expenses at hotels. They were preparing nice dossiers that were sent to main newspapers around the world. They started running stories. This was building internal domestic pressure, and then they pick up the phone and call creditors, we are ready to talk. The truth is that these are techniques to rebalance the fact that you have a sovereign state which has sovereign immunity and can adopt sovereign acts vis-a-vis a creditor with limited powers. And then going back to the other leg, let's say, of the new players, those that are sponsoring the process, we are starting to see that. That's a clear new tendency. However, my understanding or my general take is that this type of hedge funds, they prefer to buy the debt at discount and be on the driving seat. And also, it also has to do with the fact that sometimes many of the investors are retail investors, namely pensioners, and we've seen this in Argentina in their 70s, in their 80s, that Argentina was offering a new bond that will mature in 40 years from now. So basically, they prefer to cash on that, even at discount, than hold to collect on a bond that will mature in 40 years from now, when probably they might not be around.
One last small question.
So thank you. My name is Andrea Gattini. I'm professor in the University of Padua and visiting guest here at the Institute for the time. So my very short question, which has been partially preempted by the question of Professor Hess, is about the cost of litigation, the cost of arbitration. So a precision, because you said that the three Argentina cases has been settled. It's true in a way, but two of them had been actually discontinued by the tribunal because the parties didn't pay the cost of the proceedings. So on request of the secretary, the Ambiente Ufficio case and the Alemanni case has been discontinued. And this is a matter of cost. Who actually bear the cost of the proceedings. The arbitral tribunal was very clear in saying that the move to the exit may not be, must not be cost-free, may not be just a guarantee for the claimant. They didn't take any decision at the end about the cost, and so each party will bear its own costs. But the attempt by the claimant to shift the whole costs on the respondent was, of course, was the tribunal said, raised, was dealt with the question of costs very anxiously because of this aspect. So this brings me actually to the actual question. The actual question is about this third party founding. Professor Hess spoke of a vulture funds which could be interested in being behind the scene and moving some old, as we said, pensioners, whatever, Italian, 18 years old Italians. But the matter was actually was also raised before the exit in all those cases about the role of this dubious North Atlantic Société d'Administration, which was behind the claimant, which was behind the legal firm which represented them, and the Argentina contested the role of this North Atlantic Société d'Administration, which is seated in Monaco, about their interest. So, thank you.
Great, thank you. So maybe I can just very briefly also try to answer Professor Hess's questions. So on the relationship between civil litigation and investment arbitration, so I think at least in ideal form, we have, I would think that there are two categories. So we have external bonds where you governed by external law, typically external currency, where you have an express submission to the jurisdiction of the courts in London or New York, an express waiver of immunity, as compared to domestic bonds governed by domestic law, where you have no express waiver of immunity. So the point I was trying to make was that with respect to external bonds, particularly in London and New York, it is now very firmly established that these external bonds are commercial transactions. Questions have indeed arisen in other jurisdictions where you don't have an express waiver of immunity, whether or not there is jurisdiction or whether the sovereign enjoys immunity. And I think these two categories are quite, these two different categories are quite important, because traditionally, I think investment arbitration is premised on the idea that at least as a practical matter, you don't have an effective remedy before the domestic courts in the host country. Now, if you are thinking about external bonds that are submitted to an external law, subject to the jurisdiction of external courts, as was the case in Argentina, these courts are open. In fact, they have heard disputes by bondholders. So I think the justification for having investor state arbitration in that context is much more tenuous than it is in other contexts. On your third question on the actors, I think a very interesting aspect of the four investor state arbitrations we have seen arising out of sovereign bonds is that they've all been brought by what I think one could call unsophisticated investors. So we have retail investors in the Argentina cases in a comparatively small bank. So the sophisticated investors, the hedge funds, they prefer not to use litigation or arbitration, or if, then to litigate and not to go through arbitration. And to Professor Gattini's question, yes, I think this is one of the four or five major policy issues in investment, the cost issue, particularly the recovery of costs by states against claimants that have perhaps brought frivolous claims, and that where this may be very difficult. One of the four or five most significant policy issues in investor state arbitration today, particularly against the background of an average cost of 8 to 10 million of investor state arbitration. We don't have a firmly established loser pays principle, but we see a move in that direction in some very recent agreements, such as CETA. But there are very important challenges in enforcing such cost awards against investors who might be difficult to reach by the state.
If I may add to the last question, I assume that you're referring to the American Task Force, which was involved in the arbitral cases. The the truth is that basically there was a body who was nucleating and organizing the creditors. And as such, I personally don't see any dubious nature in that. It's just basically creditors being organized, as we can, which is very common in corporate insolvency procedures. Sometimes this is organized, or that's sometimes many times prescribed in the law itself, or organized by the court. In this case, in the absence of one, creditors tend to organize themselves.
It's time to thank our lecturers for these very stimulating presentations. And I would also like to thank Madame Simone Baissel, who is a member of the Luxembourgish Parliament and who made the honor of attending this lecture and visiting our institute today, following another program by the Fonds National de la Recherche, which is the pairing scheme system, and which allows members of the Parliament to discover institutes of research and researchers to discover the Parliament. Merci beaucoup, Madame, pour votre présence aujourd'hui. And thank you for this very stimulating presentation discussion. Reception is waiting for all of us outside so we can go on discussing on the less formal basis. Thank you very much and see you.